Hi folks, how we doing? I'm the Reverend Danny Crosby, a Unitarian minister serving congregations in Altrincham and in Urmston in the northwest of England. I do hope you're finding the love and that you're witnessing the blessings in life in these difficult times. It's hard, my friends, but we're all in this one together. I'm offering these devotions as my little bit of hope, doing what I can, playing my role in being part of the solution. These devotions are offered as a balm for the heart, the mind, the spirit and the soul. The title for today's devotion is Speaking Truth in Love, the Threefold Test. So I invite us just to still ourselves together now in silence. Let's invite a loving presence to be here amongst us and awaken from deep within us. I have lit the flame of freedom in the cup of belonging, acceptance, and love. This flame is lit for ourselves. Let's pause to be conscious of that which makes each of us unique. The colour of our eyes, our hair, and our skin. Our height and build, the face that is ours alone, and the inner self that no one really knows. Our heritage of genes and family, of culture and of faith, with which we build our own special lives. The abilities and disabilities that give us our potential to grow and create as no one else can. The place where we live, the town or city, the village, coast or countryside, that helps to make us who we are. Our interests and hobbies, our taste in music, the books we love, the clothes we wear, the things we like and don't like, the things that make each of us distinct. Let's give thanks for who we are, as individuals, of course, each one unique, as humankind, of course, in which our individuality contributes to the whole. So let's respect and celebrate our own uniqueness, and each other's too. May it be so. A while ago, in those days before the coronavirus, those days did exist, I attended a district meeting of our local congregations. Sue came into town with me, not to attend the meeting, no, she went to do some shopping. We both got off the tram at the top of Market Street in Manchester. Sue headed to Affleck's Palace while I headed towards Cross Street Chapel. I'd almost an hour to spare, actually, so I sauntered slowly through the crowds. It was utter, utter bedlam. It wasn't so much the shoppers, it was the folks selling their wares, whether that be goods or ideas. There were lots of football paraphernalia on sale. After all, it was the Manchester Derby the next day. I passed a slightly crazed preacher calling out the sinners in the city and the world, preaching the word of a God that I just can't relate to. There were others promoting their own religious traditions and, of course, their political causes. There was a young four-piece band playing and being filmed. As I reached the bottom of Market Street, I was confronted with a silent protest, with some horrific video images being played. I walked through utter chaos. Everyone was shouting, nay, screaming at each other. They were all drowning each other out, so much so I couldn't really hear a thing that was being said. As the song goes, everybody's talking at me, but I don't hear a word they're saying. Only they weren't talking. They were screaming about their causes, some causes very worthy ones actually. But I don't think that's the way to carry a message if you want people to listen. You know, this wasn't so long ago. Manchester is a very different scene today. Maybe some of us missed this. I'm not sure I missed this. Not that, that was crazy. I just wanted to get away, to find some peace before the meeting I was not feeling particularly enthusiastic about. So I carried on walking. I was not ready to go and sit in Cross Street Chapel. I wanted a little peace in the crazy city. So I headed towards St. Anne's Square. I wanted to sit quietly and perhaps pray alone. You know, it was a wise choice. As I reached the square, I heard the most beautiful tenor voice singing an aria. I sat down on a bench and just sank into the music as it touched my soul, my spirit, as I connected in prayerful inner silence. After 15 minutes, I rose again, put some money in the man's pot, and went to the meeting. The meeting was conducted in a good spirit, actually. There were opinions expressed, people agreed and disagreed, much was discussed, and it was all done deeply respectfully. Strong opinions were expressed, and we all listened to one another lovingly and respectfully. A lot was left unresolved, but strangely the meeting lifted my spirits. Not because of the decisions that were reached. It was not a great success in that sense. In fact, terrible really. But because of the respect in which the meeting was conducted. It was good to be in this spiritual oasis in the heart of what seemed that day and at other times a crazy city. Now sadly this appears to be a rare thing in our day and age. It seems that we the people are always shouting at one another these days. Discourse and dialogue, on the whole at least, have gone the way of the dodo. We have all but lost civility and respect. Truth's hard to find too. It seems that so many of our public figures are crying wolf all the time. Who do we trust? Who do we believe? And it would appear that debate is more about proving how wrong the other is than speaking truth in love. It seems that everybody's shouting at each other. And who amongst, so much so that who amongst us can hear a single word that's been said? We face many crises in this, our current age. One of the most destructive is the one of the loss of love, respect, dare I say, civility. We need to stop seeing one another as the enemy who we must defeat. Now, one place where decency and civility in discourse has all but disappeared is online communities. I suspect that most folk could do with some lessons in minding our cyber manners, really. An example of this was shared at that district meeting. It was shared about inconsiderate behaviour on a denominational Facebook page. It happens in all walks of life, by the way. Online abuse and bullying is growing. People say and share things online they would never dream of doing face to face. Online interaction is not the same as face to face interaction. But the damage done by inconsiderate behaviour can be equally destructive. Lies are also spread far more easily on such forums. People are disbelieved, public figures are not trusted, and in our current climate we need to trust medical experts and people don't trust them. The capacity to appear almost anonymous online can lead to ugly lies being spewed without constraint. And these can lead to the destruction of reputations. Now please don't get me wrong, I'm not wishing to come across as what some describe as a snowflake. Healthy dialogue is vital, criticism is vital too. The problem stems, I think, from how we communicate, how we offer our criticism. And there's a need for humour too. My goodness, is there. I saw much humour at that district meeting I attended, which included healthy teasing. Some folks might call it banter. I experienced it the other week at my stag do as well. Friends just joshing with each other, playing games. Friendly banter, I think they call it. Teasing. It was fun. Humour is so vital in life, and loving teasing is an expression of this. As William B. Irvine put it in A Slap in the Face, Why Insults Hurt and Why They Shouldn't. Playful teasing is one important way in which social bonds are strengthened. You don't, if you have any sense, tease strangers on the bus, since they will find your behaviour insulting. Nor do we tease people we have just met. But if you know someone and want your relationship with that person to be even closer, teasing is one way to achieve your goal. Teasing implies a level of acceptance and even intimacy. Indeed, if no one ever teases you, it could well be because they don't have any close friends. You don't have any close friends. There's no one close enough to tease you. It's a sign of something. If you spend time in my family, teasing or joshing, perhaps, as we would have called it, is a real sign of deep affection. There is a place for loving humour in the way we communicate with each other. It's a vital aspect of human bonding. It really is. So I've laid out a few things, a few problems perhaps, and maybe one or two solutions. All well and good, you may well say, but what about real solutions, other than developing a sense of humour? How should we communicate? Is there a way to do so in loving and honest ways, particularly when it comes to public discourse? Well, I think there is. Here's one. The threefold test for right speech. Maybe that's the answer. According to this test, there are three things we ought to ask ourselves before we speak. Is it kind? Is it true? Is it necessarily? Apparently, it dates back to 1835 in a poem by Beth Day titled Three Gates of Gold. This is how the poem goes. If you are tempted to reveal a tale to you someone has told about another, make it pass before you speak three gates of gold. These narrow gates. First, is it true? Then, is it needful? In your mind, give truthful answer. And next is last and narrowest. Is it kind? And if to reach your lips at last it passes through these gateways three, then you may tell you the tale nor fear what the result of speech may be. Simple, eh? Now, no doubt this poem was influenced by an old Sufi tradition which suggests that you should only speak after our words have managed to pass through four gates. So a bit tougher for the Sufis. At the first gate, we should ask ourselves, are these words true? If so, then we let them pass through. If not, then back they must go. At the second gate, we ask, are these words necessary? At the third, we ask, are these words beneficial? At the fourth gate, we ask, are they kind? If we answer no to any of these questions, then what we are about to say ought to be left unsaid. Luminaries from the Sai Baba to Eleanor Roosevelt have offered various variations on the same theme over the years. Is it kind? Is it true? Is it necessary? There's also the triple filter test usually ascribed to Socrates, which asks, is it true, good or useful? And these tests in their various forms are examples of right speech. And right speech is central to both Christian and Buddhist morality. Samavaka is the third aspect of the Noble Eightfold Path in Buddhism. It is basically abstinence from gossip, slander, lying, maliciousness and hate speech. So to speak wisely or rightly is to do so truthfully, with kindness, purpose and meaning. It is usually translated as right speech, although scholars suggest that a more accurate translation is actually wise speech. Now there are many passages in both the Old and the New Testament that refer to right speech. From Psalm 19, let the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O God. In the New Testament, the book of James makes reference to how a person should use their mouth. With it we bless God, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. The book of Ephesians chapter 4 verse 25 states, so then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbours, for we are members of one another. The Sufi, the Christian and the Buddhist traditions, as well as many other ancient and contemporary ones, have offered similar ways on which we ought to conduct ourselves with our brothers and sisters. They are saying how damaging wrong speech can be both to our neighbours and ourselves. You can kind of sense in these ideals of right speech, the essence of the golden rule of compassion, just running through it all. How we communicate is so vitally important. We may not have control over what goes on in the world or all around us, but how we act towards others really matters. We need to be mindful in how we speak, because what we say and do and what we do not say and do not do has an impact on all around us. As the old saying goes, if you've not got anything good to say, then it's probably best to keep your mouth shut. Another old saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names, they will never hurt me. I think that's nonsense. The words we use can deeply hurt and wound people. The words we speak and how we speak them have real power. The words we speak are an expression of our spirit, of where we are spiritually. They express whether we are part of the creation or the destruction of life. Yehuda Berg, an author on the Kabbalah, a mystical form of Judaism, has said, words are singularly the most powerful force available to humanity. We can choose to use this force constructively with words of encouragement, or destructively using words of despair. Words have energy and power with the ability to help, to heal, to hinder, to hurt, to harm, to humiliate, and to humble. Words are powerful. It matters what we say and how we say it, and in what spirit. We hear words and how they are spoken before we can understand them in our minds. We hear them from the moment we are born, perhaps even before we're born in our mother's womb. Here in the powerless and utterly dependent moments, the words we hear and digest have a powerful influence on the people that we become. And this continues throughout our lives. As I often say, everything matters. Every thought, every feeling, every action, every word spoken. What we say and how we say it is not the only power at work, of course not. But never, ever, ever, ever let anyone tell you it doesn't matter. You have no idea the power that you're involved in with the words you speak. Your very next sentence may be the beginning of something beautiful in the life of another. It may well play a part in changing or giving life to someone. On the other hand, it may aid in their destruction. So choose your words carefully. Ensure they are spoken in the spirit of love as a part of the creation. And when we're about to speak, we need to ask ourselves, is this kind? Is this true? Is this necessary? Because what we do and what we do not say matters, because everything matters. So may what we say be kind, true, and necessary. Amen. I'm going to end today's reflection with some final words of blessing. We need to bless more. And you know, we can all bless. We bless by giving our whole hearts to life. So let's begin today. Let's give our whole hearts to life. I offer these words as a final blessing. Many days we share life together, and flower and flow with all that is and was and ever shall be. Let us bless life through our thoughts, words and deeds, and it will bless us in return. And may the love of God be with us in all that we feel, in all that we think, in all that we say, in all that we do. Amen.